Good afternoon, everyone, and thank you for joining us for today's webinar. Today's webinar is sponsored by Agilent Technologies. The topic of today's event is the use of a quick probe in the analysis of controlled substances. My name is Josh Vickers. I'll be your host for today. I'm with Forensic Ed with RTI International. Our subject matter expert and speaker for today is Dr. Aaron Shaughnessy. Dr. Shaughnessy received a PhD in chemistry from the University of Alabama at Birmingham. She then started her career with the Alabama Department of Forensic Sciences, ADFS, in 2008, where she continues to serve as the Director of Research at ADFS. Aaron is responsible for developing and validating new methods for use in the analysis of controlled substances. Now, without any further ado, I would like to hand the microphone and platform over to our speaker and presenter today, Dr. Aaron Shaughnessy. Dr. Shaughnessy?
Thank you, Josh. All right, are we good? Okay.
Yep, your presentation is up. You are ready to go.
Perfect. Sounds good. Thank you, everybody, for joining us this afternoon. What I have been asked to talk about today is something that is a little bit different, at least for me, when I was approached about it. So it's the use of a quick probe in the analysis of controlled substances. And what I plan on doing is going through kind of how our controlled substance unit is set up in Alabama and how we made use of this new technology to see how it would work with our workflow and our plans for efficiency within the laboratory. So in 2019, the face of our drug, we call drug chemistry in Alabama, the face of our drug chemistry section is a little bit different than when I started in 2008. We've moved a lot of our processes to actually mimic a lot of what happens in toxicology. We do a lot of batch work now. We try to flow our efficiency much better so that we're trying to increase our turnaround time or decrease our turnaround time, which is what a lot of people are looking for currently. In Alabama, we have five service regions for our state laboratory system, and each service region has a laboratory that'll work there. So we have a Huntsville laboratory in the north of our state. Birmingham works the central portions of the state. Auburn will work on the eastern side of our border. Mobile works our western side, and then Montgomery will work our central to the southern side. So we have five different laboratory locations, and what is key for us in Alabama is that if we have technology in one of our locations, our ultimate goal is to have technology in all of our locations. That way, if you are having your case worked in Montgomery, the results you'll see out of Montgomery are the same as what you would see out of our Birmingham laboratory or our Huntsville laboratory. So the key, obviously, is to make everything the same across the whole state as opposed to just in one of our single laboratory locations. The way we approach our controlled substance analysis is we have to meet one of the following criteria before we will stop working a case. So one of the first things is that the number of items analyzed achieves sufficient weight to meet a trafficking charge. What we do is currently, after speaking to our customers, we don't weigh our evidence any longer unless it is open for a trafficking charge. That includes, marijuana, your opiates, all those things. We'll weigh all those if there is any weight-bearing charge associated with it. So if we have an intent to distribute charge or trafficking or anything like that, we will weigh it, and then we will analyze every single item that meets that weight. So we don't do a sampling system where you can do like a statistical approach to it. We will actually, if it takes us 300 tablets to get to second-level trafficking, then we will analyze the 300 tablets, which, as you may realize, can be quite an undertaking if you have to make 300 injections on the GCMS. So that's something that, again, we like to try to streamline our process on. Next, if the number of items analyzed reveal the elements to meet a manufacturing charge. So we have the manufacturing charge. So if we're looking at a clandestine laboratory and we're looking and we find pseudoephedrine and methamphetamine, we'll stop our analysis then because we have met our charge of manufacturing. The next thing that we look for is the number of items analyzed achieves sufficient weight to do an intent to distribute charge, which I've already discussed. So again, we're working to our charges. You will find that, we're in communication with our DAs and our officers to figure out what the charges are. At least one item of non-trafficking weight marijuana in a controlled substance is identified. So we're looking at a marijuana and a controlled substance charge. And then finally, we'll stop working the case if the controlled substance is identified. So that's kind of how we work through our system. So let's say we get in a case that has, you know, 20 packets of synthetic cannabinoids on it, but only, you know, six of them meet our trafficking charge, then we will work six of the packets and identify everything in that because we've met our charge. So this is kind of our approach to how we work cases within the chemistry lab in Alabama. We also work based on what we call a tier system. So what we're looking at in our tier system in our approach is we're looking, one, at weight-bearing charges, and then we're looking at schedules and public danger, so public risks. So when everything was coming out, you know, as everybody heard about with all the fentanyl analogs that were coming out mixed with heroin or standalone, or we've seen a lot of them as counterfeit tablets, those are going to hit a public danger note for us. And we like to work those quickly and efficiently to make sure that we're getting those cases handled. So those will be our next tier down. Then we look at other dangerous substances or Schedule 2. And then finally, the last tier that will work, so that may get pushed until we have a chemist available to do it, would be residues and paraphernalia. So a lot of what we look at, again, we put more focus on our public danger risks and our trafficking, our intent to distribute, our manufacturing risks. And that is the other way that we handle our casework as we are giving it out to the scientists. We have 40 analysts or 40 scientists in the chemistry section. And so every section chief that we have in each laboratory location is responsible for making sure that our casework is distributed in this fashion. So just for our fiscal year 2018, we received 38,000 cases and we reported about 39,000. So again, we're not taking in a small number of cases. We do see quite a few cases come in our door every year, and you'll see that we received our 38,000. 30,000 of those went out with a report of a controlled substance, and then what we did have was some instances of adjudicated cases. And in these instances of adjudicated cases, we had about 4,600 that came in as service canceled. So they came in and said, you know what, we don't need you to work this case anymore. They either pled or the charges got dropped, or we have a setup with our Office of Courts that will tell us if it has already gone through the court system. And so if there's already been a plea on it, then that'll come in, and then the case can get closed from there. So that's how we received our 39,000 that we were able to get reported out. Now, for every of those 30,000 cases that got reported, we do, like the majority of chemistry labs do, we have to use two different samples on two different technologies in order to report these cases. So that being said, we need to find a way to make our first sampling a very broad screen to help us streamline our confirmation. Our confirmations are done with GC-MS. We either derivatize or we do underivatized. We do FTIR. We have a variety of techniques available to us, but everything must go out with a GC mass spec analysis before we'll put a report out on it. So that is one of our requirements in our SOP. So all 30,000 of those cases, and that's not items, just cases, had to have that double down analysis on it. And you'll see our case intake holds pretty steady. So, you know, in 2018, we saw a little bit of an increase. We think, you know, there's a variety of factors that may come in on that. You're seeing an increased war on the opiates, and we think that that's enabling a lot of our submitters to be able to go after these cases to bring in more cases for that. But in general, what we always look for throughout every year is the way to stay efficient and to stay on top of things and to bring in any technology in our laboratory that we think would really be helpful in us achieving this goal. So that's something that my administration has always been very vocal about, is making sure that we stay on top of things, and if there's something out there that's going to help us do that, then we get in a situation where we can figure that out. So just looking at 2018, you can see, and I'm sure this holds true for, you know, the majority of the controlled substance labs out there, about 35% of our cases were marijuana cases. You see our next big hit is amines. So by amines, we're talking about methamphetamine, amphetamine, phentermine. We include our MDMA, so our clandestine tablets are included in that. You also see, you know, cocaine is our next big hit, and then narcotics, that's where we're including our hydrocodone, our oxycodone, our heroin, and our fentanyls. Or actually, fentanyl we separated out in this particular one. So you can see, you know, I hate to call them the oldies but goodies, but the ones that you've seen consistently in casework are still ones that we see majorly within the cases that come in our door and that we report. We do see our synthetic cannabinoids have hit about 5% of our reported results, which is higher than it has been previously. So with every synthetic cannabinoid that comes in, we do a validation for that prior to reporting. But we are seeing, you know, those reports increase. 5% is not a huge amount, but it's more, it used to be 1% to 2% of our casework. So this is just kind of a breakdown of what we see within our controlled substances laboratory as we're looking at our cases. So what we were looking at with the use of the Quick Probe is just this new instrumentation and a different way to screen unknown samples. So traditionally, before I came in and started in 2008, a lot of the ways that our scientists in controlled substances was screening things is using color tests. They would use FTIR sometimes. They would use GC-MS, or they would use microcrystal would be the primary routes that they would take. So we started implementing different technology to look at different ways to screen, kind of widen the base and decrease the work that had to be put in for the screen. When I say work, I just mean we wanted to do as little as possible to the sample prior to screening it. That way, you're not potentially leaving something behind in extraction that you needed to know or leaving something out that you didn't know was in there to begin with because it's a new compound. So the Quick Probe was a new piece of instrumentation that we wanted to look at as a different way to screen samples than we have been doing up until the present point. So what the Quick Probe is it's, excuse me, it's a real-time technique that enables you to identify compounds with little to no sample preparation. Really what I'm going to go through today is what we found as we were going through our work with this. So how much of it was little preparation, how much of it was no, and how much of it is something that we really needed to think about before we put it on there. So it sits in a detector position on the GC-MS, and for us, actually, we took advantage of that because what we did when we set this up is we left our auto sampler on our GC mass spec, and then what we could do if it was absolutely necessary, let's say we needed to run something on that mass spec, we could pull the column from the Quick Probe out, and then we could put the column from our inlet auto sampler in, and we could run it the traditional way as well. So we were able to set it up to run both. I'm not going to say it was the easiest venture to do that, but it was certainly something that we could do, say, over the weekend if we wanted to run a long batch on that GC. And then a sample containing a probe is inserted into the inlet, and you'll see it's pointing over here, which is a little bit different than an inlet you typically think about on a GC mass spec. Still just a thought, though. I also learned that the hard way. But it is open to the ambient air. And then you have a short column that sits within the Quick Probe itself that is rapidly heated, and it provides separation of your analytes. So that separation is something that you could take advantage of if you sat down and really worked with your method. And then, again, you have an EI, single quadrupole mass spec is what we had ours set up on, and it gives you a spectra just like you're used to seeing on your traditional GC-MS that's running your 15 or your 30-meter columns. So the way that it started is, you know, you just touch your sample with the glass probe, solid, liquid, powder. I have to say, anytime I get an opportunity to use new systems like this and really put them through their paces, I will throw anything at it I can. And so we did a whole lot more than just a, you know, a powder or a tablet. We threw edibles at it, oils, plant material, pretty much anything I could get my hands on if people were having a discussion about it, we would try with this system. And then you'll see it's injected. It goes through the analytical column. There is basically a blank capillary that'll hook it into your mass spec, and you get your spectrum that comes out of it. And we use just our traditional libraries. So we have, you know, the NIST library, the Wiley library. We use the Cayman Library, the American AAFS Library. We used all of these in our searches because this is what we use on all of our GC mass spec systems. So wanted to see if the libraries that we're using can hold up under this. And in reality, you're not really changing any of your source settings, so there's no reason you shouldn't be able to. These are the operating parameters that we set up with our Quick Probe. So we ran it in split mode I always like to tease. I've worked both in toxicology and chemistry, and I like to say that in chemistry we are at times backing up a dump truck full of compound to put on these columns. So, you know, I immediately, when we started working with this, went into split mode because the key is to not overload the system. As everyone knows, once you overload the system, your spectrum will start to look weird. Things will start to hang around, and that's just not something you want to do if the goal in what you're looking for is to run it as efficiently as possible. So the inlet temperature was set at 250. The runtime, the total runtime was 36 seconds for the analysis that we were doing. So the injection time was 5 seconds, and basically what that was is you would sit with the probe in the inlet for those 5 seconds. When that 5 seconds was up, you would remove the probe from the inlet. And we started at 40 degrees and ramped it, at 10 degrees per second up to 340 degrees and hold it for 3 seconds. So that's where the 36-second method came from. And again, it's a short column. It's a fast method. The goal is to get it into the source to get you that identification. You're not necessarily going to be looking at, and you'll see throughout this, you're not going to be looking at the prettiest chromatography that you're going to get out of it, and that's a matter of really what you want to put into it to get out of it. So when we started again with what you saw in the basic first slide. Let's go ahead and dip that probe in our raw sample and, you know, tap off the excess powder. The key for us is we've got to reduce contamination any way possible. What we are looking for is to be able to put, you know, 30 or 40 samples through this in a day, ideally 50 or 60, but people started looking at me like I was, you know, a little bit crazy when I started talking about that. So 30 or 40, but if you're going to be sitting in front of it and sampling there, you have to make sure you're reducing any chance of contamination between samples. So everything that was done to try to decrease that, we used paper weigh boats or weigh paper or anything to try to keep everything contained. So we would dip the probe in the raw sample and tap off that excess powder, insert the probe in the probe holder, and inject the sample. And so the question is, as we started, you know, playing with it, is, okay, if we do it simple and easy and fast like that, how does it come out looking? And this is just an example of one that we ran, a marked capsule. Like I said, I pretty much, what I could put my hands on, I put my hands on to run this. So this is an amobarbital and acetobarbital capsule that we put in, and we just tapped the powder out of the capsule, and we tapped the probe into that. And so the way we set up our analysis is that first a system blank is run. And basically what you're using your system blank to do is to demonstrate that your system is clean, that anything that you're saying is present in the system in your actual case sample is only present in your case sample. It's not in the system. So we would see a couple little peaks here and there that didn't really identify as anything, maybe like a ester that was sticking in our system. So we were looking for a clean tick within the system. And again, this is, we don't inject anything. We're literally just sitting in front of the instrument hitting go on this. Next, we would do a probe blank. So in our system, or in our laboratory, this was a really important step within that. And what this probe blank does is basically we would treat it as a negative control. It would show us, okay, if I'm going to turn around and say that this screened positive for cocaine, I want to prove my point that cocaine wasn't on the probe prior to me sampling it. So what we would do is take that probe that we're going to sample with, put it in the probe holder, and inject that for our probe blank to show what exactly you are seeing on the probe. And what we saw is, you can see we did get a peak out of our probe blank, and this was a peak that we saw on pretty much every probe that we ran. We got a library match to a hexadioic acid, an ethyl hexyl ester off of that. So that could kind of be treated as a way to show that your probe did inject. Because, again, I was able to clean that off. We did go through a cleaning procedure to get that off because I did find there are times that that does interfere with compounds that are on there. But in general, I could use that peak that we would see to show that the probe did make an injection, kind of like an internal standard, without actually having to spike anything in it. So we could show, okay, we did inject a probe. We see that background peak that we see on our probe, and then we would library match it to that. So following the probe blank, we would dip that probe in that sample that we were looking to test. So again, we dipped it in that marked capsule. So this is what our tick looked like. It was cleaner than I was first expecting it to be. So you can see we have kind of a double peak here. We're not really getting baseline resolution, not that I would, with those two compounds, expect baseline resolution with the system that we're running. But, you know, we see when we do our components chromatogram that we are getting, you know, two different components identified within it. I did the data analysis with MassHunter on this particular set of compounds. And we get a good library match with amibarbital, a library match score of 99.2. You can see here with the over and under, we have nice lineup on our major ions identified overall. It was a good match. And then again with the secobarbital, we had a match of the 97.3. So both compounds that we know we injected based on that marked capsule, we were able to get, and we were able to get a library match score of over 90% with those. And in general, we had good chromatography on that. So our early system worked on this particular capsule. What we would do then after we would inject our samples is we would run a second system blank. And kind of the point of the second system blank is to clean out everything and to make sure that, you know, what we're looking at, again, that we're not seeing anything that is going into our next sample. Because what we want to do ultimately, right, is I said we want to be able to inject 30 or 40 of these at a time. Well, you don't want to have something that came from six samples ago showing up. So we run the second system blank to see, okay, is my system actually clean, or do I need to hit pause and clean out the system? So again, what you're looking for here is just a nice blank chromatogram, and you can see we had some peaks in there. So you would hit pause to kind of get some of these peaks out of your way. So, you know, we ran a marked tablet. We knew what we were putting in there. Everybody in any controlled substance lab is used to the off-white powder, the white powder, the tan powder that comes in, and it comes in maybe with a field test that the officer did on it, or it comes in, you know, it's a white powder, it's going to be cocaine, or however people are thinking. But again, the key to this is to just go into it saying, I'm not going to make any assumptions about this. We want to screen it and see what it looks like. So, you know, we took our unknown tan powder and we wanted to test the system with this. We tested it with just the same sequence that I was talking about, the system blank, probe blank, dipping it in the powder, and then another system blank. And what we can see in our unknown tan powder, so this is our tick, we had a large chunk of something that wasn't identified come out, and then this is our components chromatogram. So these two peaks were identified within this. And when we looked at this, what we saw is we saw 6-MAM and heroin, both with very high library match scores. So the heroin, again, being this larger peak at the 3.818, and then the 6-MAM that we tend to see with it when we analyze the heroin. So again, we got a good match score on this. Heroin, depending on how it's cut, can be tricky to get a screen on. So it was good to see that we could get the heroin off of this. We didn't seem to see a lot of other components on it other than the two. So 99.5, that was a good library score on that one. We have another one that was a marked tablet. So anytime I had a marked tablet where it was a tablet and it wasn't a powder, what I would do is I would take the probe and simply scrape the tablet, or we would take a scraping of the tablet. The key that we really wanted to do was get beyond the coating on the outside of the tablet. So scrape the coating off the tablet and then scrape where that coating had been removed to get. So you can see we have a coating match here. It's not the cleanest spectrum that we have, but it also wasn't a hugely concentrated sample based on this. So based on what we were doing, we are starting to see some effects in our tick based on the binders that were in there and just kind of what the system was and just how low that particular compound was within that sample. But we still have our match score of 96.5. And if we're looking at this in terms of a screen, that's something you could then turn around and say, I can put this in my coding batch with controls in order to confirm it. We have another, we get a lot of unknown liquids in that'll come in, whether they come in as steroids or oils. You know, we're getting a lot of the vaping liquids that are coming in now. So liquids are something that can certainly be a challenge to screen when you're looking at things as they come in, and they can also be a challenge just in running them on any system, depending on whether it's a syrup or how sticky it is or how viscous it can be. So this is an unknown liquid that came in. Again, we just dipped the probe within the liquid. The key with liquids is to be really careful on how much you're dipping it within the liquid. We learned that the very hard way, and then to wipe it off. So on this one, we dipped it in. We were able to get a nice signal off of it with a match to testosterone. I was worried steroids on this, that they would come out in a following sample, just because I didn't know a 36-second method is really quick. I know our steroid method on our GC mass spec is really rather long to try to give everything time to elute off the column because they tend to be bigger. But we didn't have a problem with this coming off in this particular analysis. So that was interesting to see. I put this on there to see if steroids would be a problem. Of the ones we tested, we didn't find that any of them would linger or wouldn't come out. Of course, the off-white compressed material, and this is where we really wanted to kind of start pressing it, because we know, at least in our analysis, when we're looking at cocaine, that cocaine is just really nice to analyze. It will run through your chromatography system well. It gives you a nice EI spectra, but sometimes it's a little too nice, a little too friendly, and it likes to linger. So we took this, off-white compressed material and injected it. And what you can see is that this is where we started to learn that sampling became more than just let's just tap it in to our compound, whatever we're looking for, and inject it. So what we saw here is we saw some peaks, and then basically I plateaued out the system with the cocaine that we saw. So this giant peak that you're seeing right here is going to be the cocaine, and it really, really overloaded the system. So if you think back to our analysis or our caseload, and we're talking about 12% of our cases are cocaine, this could be potentially problematic for us if this is going to be what it looks like. And when we look at our compound analysis, you can see we get a cocaine match score of 97.2, so we didn't have any problem matching it. We didn't, our tick doesn't look great. If you aren't looking at a chromatography component to this, so if the only thing you're interested in is the spectrum, you may not be overly concerned. The fact that your tick looks like it, in fact, is just a giant plateau that's in there. Us, we don't necessarily like messy peaks like that, but sometimes they happen depending on how you're approaching the technology. But what happened afterwards is where, things started to become a little more challenging, and that was, if we look at our system blank, we actually have very nice chromatography now, a nice peak of our cocaine. So this is our system blank following the sampling, and then this is our system blank for the next sample. So you can see that basically what happened here is we sampled the particular compound and then we injected it, and it fell off basically into our inlet. So what we got was cocaine, and it literally ran through the rest of the sequence for me. And that's when it was, okay, well, this could be problematic, because what we can't do is this ended up resulting in a liner change. So I had to go in and change the liner to get this cocaine signal out of the rest of my runs. And what you don't want to do if you're looking for something efficient is have to take it down and change the liner out every time you have a cocaine sample. So this is something that really caught our attention, because again, we're looking for efficiency here, and it is something that we found could happen. In fact, I did it quite often as I was working on this and learning kind of my way through the system. It got to be a joke after a while. People would ask me how many liners I had gone through. But again, it was all a learning analysis on this. The other thing that can happen, and that happened quite easily with the way we started our sampling, is it was very easy to overload our sample and to really just kind of saturate out everything. So we took an unknown oil here, and you can see we dipped it in the oil and we wiped it off, but it wasn't quite enough for us. So we just got a very ugly chromatogram. And if you're going through your analysis and you're doing it the traditional chemstation way, where you're peak picking and looking for your library matches, I can tell you that kind of melded in with all the other oil components within it. So it took quite a bit of work to tease that out of it. It was just basically a sample overload, which tells us again that it's time to consider modifying the way that we were sampling our compounds. And I always tell people, we use different instruments within our laboratory that sampling can be challenging on. And like anything where you're doing a direct injection of a sample and you're not doing it with a solvent, It's very much an art. So loose powder left on the sample rod can and did lead to carryover. It was something that we certainly battled, and it carried over into the rest of the samples within the sequence. It also, loose powder could get on the sample probe if you weren't careful. So then you had it on your sample probe and you've changed your liner, but you're still seeing it. So these are all the things that we chased down as we were starting to use this. So I would put in the blank sample probe just to make sure that we didn't have any contamination on that. I found rinsing it with water was the easiest way to just kind of keep that in check. We also found too much liquid left on the sampling rod can and did lead to overloading and poor chromatography. And then depending on the type of liquid, it would also lead to carryover. So we may have, we get a lot of cough syrups to analyze here, and we may have guaifenesin for days in the system on the syrup if we didn't sample it appropriately. So what we did is we kind of went back to the drawing board to readjust the way we were sampling these. So what I didn't want to do was say, okay, forget this. Let's go ahead and put everything in solvent, because that defeats the whole purpose. The whole purpose is to be able to look at your compound in the raw form, and we didn't want to take that away. So let's not jump to that. Let's go ahead and see if there's a different way we can do that. So we went back to the drawing board on our sampling to see if we could modify it at all and not cause a hindrance to ourselves, but not have to put everything through an extraction or through a dilution into solvent. So we took the pocket tip probe and would dip that in raw sample. And what we would do is then take the pocket and press it down against the table and rinse the probe with methanol. So any loose powder that's sitting up on the sides of your probe that would be the problem for falling off into the inlet or into the sample probe, you're now rinsing that off with methanol, and then you're inserting that into your probe holder and injecting that. So you're basically adding an additional step where you're basically rinsing your powders or your oil drips that are still dripping on there or anything that's just on there. And we would use, if we needed to, we would use the weigh paper or the paper weigh boat to wipe it down. If we had a lot of methanol on there, we'd let the methanol dry, and then we would inject it. We did find we could do that during our system blank so that we weren't, or, you know, after our probe blank, so that we weren't sitting there just waiting or having to pause our sequence continuously, because that would, again, defeat the purpose of being able to run this within a sequence. So what we saw when we did this, remember, so this is our unknown oil that we did that was sample overloaded. So we took that same oil and we just did it where we did the, used a pocket tip and then rinsed it. Basically, the whole point of putting the pocket down on the table was to protect whatever was in the pocket so that you still had some of your sample. We tried it without doing that, and you basically rinsed the entirety of your sample off. But if you put it down on the table and just applied a gentle pressure, it would keep the methanol from rinsing things out of the pocket so that you were still injecting what was in there, but it wasn't falling off out into your inlet. So we went from a chromatogram that looked really rather overloaded. This is the same liquid that we injected, but this is a probe rinse. And you can see we had much better chromatography on this. We're still identifying the same compound. It was a cannabidiol oil. We got a match 99.5, but you can see how much we cleaned up our chromatogram by adding that particular probe rinse into our sampling technique that we wanted to add in. So it was proving useful for us to do that way. And what we did was then modify, go back to everything that we did, because we found certain compounds just really, really, really like to stick around. Heroin was one that really liked to stick around. Our cocaine, again, really like to stick around, and our syrups did. So we modified it, and everything went back through the system with the probe rinse to just kind of clean up our chromatograms and what we were seeing. So we did find that it did clean it up in the majority of things. We still have matrix effects, which, again, you're not doing an extraction, so you're not really removing the matrix. You're pretty much injecting the matrix as well onto the system. So while our probe rinse helps clean out carryover that comes from particles falling off of our probe or falling into the inlet or even just an overload, you still have the syrups, right? The syrups that are sticking have a lot of sugars in them. Those are still getting injected. So we would still see matrix effects on these. We also found that, you know, if we're looking at edibles are something that's coming into analysis quite a bit more often here in Alabama. If I would just, and I did, dip it in a gummy bear to see what would happen, because again, the key is, do I have to extract this or do I not have to extract this for analysis? Anything that had a really complex matrix would still give us an issue, which again is not overly shocking because you're not separating out any of the matrix. So you're going to just be injecting the problem analytes that you are with your analyte of interest. That being said, if we had some of these where our analyte of interest was in higher concentration, we would be able to see that without doing an extraction. But it definitely had to be one where it was a much higher concentration of the analyte of interest than some of the edibles that we were seeing or some of the syrups that we were seeing. So this is just an example of what we would see in our analysis when we were looking at an oil. So again, excuse me, what you see is just this is the CBD, and this is the matrix effects that we would see if it's a lower concentration or if we just didn't get our cleanup right. You would see just kind of a, you lose your peak within your matrix, and if you're peak picking on ChemStation, right, or whatever you peak pick with, and you would peak pick that, you wouldn't get a library match based on it. So the library match we got was based on deconvolution. But when the matrix would really get in there and cause problems, we would lose our library matches on things. And then what we would do is just for a sample like this, it would either try retesting with a better probance, or it would be something that would have to be extracted if you wanted to get a usable library match on. Or again, play with chromatography conditions to try to see if you could separate out some of those matrix effects that we would see. A big thing for us as we look for ways to screen our cases that are coming in is things that are emerging. So, everyone talks about the emerging compounds and, what are we doing with them and how are you looking at them? And the reason that they can gain so much traction is not just that they're new and fun to talk about, but that it can be a challenge in traditional analysis. So when we get plant material in our laboratory, traditionally what we do with plant material is it undergoes a macroscopic and a microscopic examination to look for the presence of, marijuana characteristics, systolithic hairs, and then we also will do a GC-MS to look for the presence of THC. Well, when we started getting the synthetic cannabinoids, that takes away your macro-micro analysis, and then it introduces the new challenge of, well, you've got to second test it. The way our laboratory would look at it is we didn't want to do two solvent extraction GC-MSs. We wanted to see if there was a different way to look at it, avoiding extractions, anything like that. So all of these emerging trends could prove to be a problem when you're looking for ways to screen them. And what I really wanted to see is how this particular setup would handle some of these that come in on interesting matrices that maybe you're not used to, or if it's something that you're just not used to seeing, making sure you have the right libraries loaded. So synthetic cannabinoids, again, you saw they're about up to 5% of what we report. We are getting, that case pretty steady, that case type pretty steadily in the lab now. So they're sprayed on plant material. It can depend on what type of plant material they're sprayed on, but majority of the time, it's not within the plant material. It's sprayed on. So the question is, can you take advantage of the fact that, excuse me, that these compounds are sprayed on the plant material and not something you have to extract out of the plant material? So what we did is you can see this is just an example of some of the analytes of interest that we've identified in our synthetic cannabinoids in 2018. And this picture is going to change all the time because they just keep changing. So, and again, I'm sure anyone who has done this analysis is very familiar with that fact as well. It's just going to keep changing as they change what they put on the plant material. And trying to keep up with the way to screen all of these can be a challenge. So we are seeing more of them, and we're seeing quite a variety of them. Again, sometimes your plant material has only one sprayed on it, sometimes it has three or four. So it's how can we do this without really having to modify the plant material? So what we did is I took some of the plant material we had where the compound was sprayed on, and I just rubbed the glass capillary, the probe, against the plant material. So we didn't put any solvent in it. We didn't put any plant material in the pocket. It was literally just taking the rounded bottom probe and rubbing it on the plant material itself to see anything that was sprayed on. Could we rub it onto our probe and analyze it? And I was pleasant. I will be honest. I was very skeptical of the idea. I was pleasantly surprised to see that you could, in fact, just rub it on the plant material, and then we would get our analyte of interest would come out with a library match of 93. We don't see a huge matrix effect from this because we're not putting a whole lot of matrix in it. So we're not taking the plant material itself, not taking, you know, crushed up pieces of gummies or anything like that. We're literally just rubbing the chemical component off of the plant material. So, you know, anything that's been sprayed on the plant material, you know, could rub off. But we did see the AM2201 come off with this. And I didn't really have to do a whole lot to it other than, you know, just rub it on there. I will say I didn't rinse this particular probe because the whole point was we were rubbing it on there. I wasn't capturing it in a pocket or anything. So we did not do the methanol rinse in this particular analysis or any time that I analyzed any of our potentially synthetic cannabinoid-containing plant material. Again, with the edibles, this is something we wanted to see. Edibles are becoming something we're seeing more commonly in our laboratory system. So they aren't necessarily fun to work with. We want to avoid dilute and shoots on edibles. We want to do extractions. But because we do everything in batch analysis, we want to make sure we're batching everything properly in the first place. So what I did was try to rub it on the edibles themselves. So I would take the probe. So the key thing is not to stab the edible, which, again, you learn things the hard way sometimes. That just takes off a lot of the matrix. But if you have, say, an edible that has a very high amount of the analyte that is in there in it, I did see just rubbing the probe on the edible itself would give us, you know, a match to that particular compound. Again, this match came with the deconvolution. So peak picking on it, we didn't get the match out from this peak, but we did get it when we used the Mass Hunter software that did the deconvolution on it. So an edible, we had the edible with low amounts of analyte of interest that we didn't see the peaks on. But again, if it had a decent amount, just rubbing it on the edible itself seemed to give us a signal. If we were doing too much, if we were putting too much of the actual food matrix in the probe, it could prove challenging. And then kratom is one that we do have to identify here in Alabama. So we see that either in capsule form. We don't get, you know, the leaves, but we do see it in capsule form. We'll see it in liquid form quite a bit. And that's another one, you know, that we need to find a good screen on. So this is one I was really interested in seeing how it did. At this point in time in my playing with it, the metragenine just isn't at a concentration in any of these where it can go on unextracted and give us a match. So we did not see the metragenine in our suspected kratom samples. It's a fairly low component in what we were testing. So we were testing a lot of liquids because, again, liquids can be a challenge to screen. So this is one that, you know, in going back to the drawing board on that, we probably would have to do an extraction to kind of bring that out, to take out some of the matrix or find a different way to look at that. So that's kind of some of the new and emerging stuff that we have in our state that we really wanted to put the instrument through its paces on to see what it looked like and how it would handle it. And I was pleasantly surprised with the synthetics and you know, it's not going to hit 100% on everything, but it to be able to not have to extract that synthetic was helpful. So our plant material samples, they were easily analyzed with the probe. We didn't rinse it or wipe it down. The edible samples were analyzed without extraction. I think, you know, edibles are something that's always going to be a 50-50 chance of you're going to have to extract it or not. The kratom samples, we found the metragenine, which is the compound that's controlled here in Alabama, is something that we would just have to extract out to be able to get that. But again, every instrument has its pros and cons with it. So it's a matter of teasing it out and teasing the system out and then finding a way to make it work with what you're looking at. I analyzed 50 different types of samples on here. So this is just an example of everything that I've analyzed on the system. What you can see that is highlighted in yellow are ones that did not match what we had expected it to have. So we had one clonazepam that was giving us a phenylephrine match. We weren't getting the GHB, which I'm not overly shocked by that, to be honest with you. We missed a hydromorphone. I can tell you in the nicotinamide pseudoephedrine sample, it was very heavy on the nicotinamide, and that was a large component of the chromatogram. So you can see, you know, we had quite a few that gave us a match to it, and then we had some where we didn't get a match to it. So 41 of our 50 samples analyzed had the major compounds identified properly. We did find, again, the synthetic plant material was easily analyzed with the analyte without any sample preparation necessary, which was nice to find. Analyte identification was made in the majority of our raw samples. However, you know, sample introduction can be a challenge. So it is definitely something that needs to be worked with and found a way for it to work within the system. Not everything that we're finding at this particular moment in time can be treated the same way. Not to be said that it can't be found a way for it to work. So we certainly have been putting it through its paces just to try to increase the number of types of introductions you can make without having to do an extraction. That being said, that's left me to any questions that anybody might have regarding this.